Nya disebutnya apa?
Udah hafal.
Oh, udah lah.
Mulai ya. Greetings, friends from wherever you are. Welcome to the International Webinar Ambassadors and Young Leaders Week 2020. With me, Michelle, who will accompany our great speakers and moderators as the master of ceremony during this event. The theme of this event will discuss science and technology. And this event will take over 2 hours from 5 to 7 p.m. Jakarta time, which will be moderated by Mr. Hilmi Al-Farouqi for the first session and Mr. Francesco Reddy Caro-Caro for the second session. For your information, this event aims to stimulate a sense of awareness of the significance extensive networking and global collaboration among Indonesian people. The ultimate goal to overcome the present-day global crisis and seek for an opportunity to people to lead the world, study COVID-19 and its domino effects. Furthermore, please allow me to introduce our great speakers for today's session. First is Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar, the president of PPI Tiongkok. And the second is Mr. Randy Finanda, the president of PPI India. The third, Mr. Ali Iksanul Kauli, the president of Perpika or Korea, South Korea, and the Mr. Ferlito Arnold Sol, the president of Permira or Russia. Before we begin, I would like to inform you that in this event, we are also raising funds for COVID-19, especially for our medical team who are at the forefront in fighting COVID-19. If you want to donate, please refer to the bank account number or scan the QR code as shown below or on your screen. Thank you very much to all of you who have contributed to the donation. Without further ado, I will pass the event to our moderators, Mr. Hilmi Al-Farouqi and Mr. Francesco Reddy. The stage is yours.
Thank you, Ms. Michelle, for the time. Greetings. My name is Muhammad Hilmi Al-Farouqi. I'm a postdoctoral fellow at Chonam National University, Republic of Korea. I'm also chief editor of OISA Journal. First and foremost, I would like also to extend my warmest welcome to all audience. I will moderate our first session today with Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar, President of Indonesian Student Association in Tiongkok, and also Mr. Randy Fernanda, President of Indonesian Students Association in India. Before we start, I will read our event background. The constant invention of new technologies has helped us survive different challenges in the past. Today, technology has entered into various aspects in our lives, such as politics, economics, and health. We are now in a time where everything is completely automated and connected with another. This is a term we familiarly address as the Industrial Revolution 4.0. Therefore, it is very critical that future emerging leaders are able to keep up with the constantly advancing technologies and use their full potential for the good of the country. Therefore, this session will discuss the role of science and technology in combating COVID-19, as well as preparing Indonesian global emerging leaders for a society where human and technology will live alongside one another. We hope we can learn a lot and get valuable insight from our speakers today. There will be a Q&A session and discussion with the speakers after the presentation. For those who have questions, please write your name and your country or region, followed by your question. We will choose the best question from the audience for the speakers to answer. Without waiting any longer, we invite the first speaker, Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar, to deliver his presentation. With that, I ask you to give full attention to Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar and help me in welcoming him to the stage. Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar, the stage is yours.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Hilmi, for the chance. Good afternoon in Indonesia's time, everybody. Good evening or maybe even good morning in any kind of part of the world that wherever you are. Before we start, allow me to express my fullest support, fullest appreciation to the organizers who have organized this wonderful event, who have invited all of the young leaders, all of the leaders around the world to discuss the things that what we can do, what we can learn from our respective countries in the aspect of dealing COVID-19, especially in using science and technology in dealing with COVID-19 itself. Allow me to introduce myself. My name is Nikolai Ali Akbar Falayati, or my friends usually call me Nico Akbar. Right now, I am the president of Indonesian Students Association in the People's Republic of China. And in this occasion, I would like to share about how do China use science and technology to deal or to fight with COVID-19 itself. Well, when we talk about two things that were happening right now, the first thing is COVID-19. The second thing is about science and technology, or the technology and the IT itself, information technology. There is one country that comes into our mind directly. Which country is that? It is China. Why? Because China has been the pioneer of technological advancement in each era. And the second one is because China is has become one of the most one of the pioneering technological advancement in the world, and as well as the country in which COVID-19 firstly present itself. Now, in my presentation, in this occasion, there are four main points that I would like to share with all of you guys. The first one is the China's technology advancement in two different perspectives, in the history perspective and in the present day perspective. The second one is the major roles of Chinese platform in dealing with COVID-19 itself, as well as the major roles of platform that science and technology platform in dealing with COVID-19. And the third one is what did they actually do in dealing with the pandemic itself. And the third and the last one is what kind of lessons that we could learn from China's experience in dealing with COVID-19 and also in using technology in this fight. Against the pandemic. Okay, next slide. Okay, next. We can skip this part. Okay. The next one is I would like to talk about the historical perspective of the Chinese technological advancement. Like since ancient times, China has become the pioneering country that has the most technological advancement beyond its era, in its respective era. The most prominent one is the four great invention, which is the compass invention, gunpowder invention, paper making invention, and the printing invention. These four great inventions, the inventions that was later called the four great inventions, it was the most prominent one, or the most prominent achievement of China in its era long time ago, because with these four, we could do almost literally anything in our daily life. We need gunpowder to make weapons. We need gunpowder to make fireworks. We need gunpowder to make anything that works in our daily life. We need paper and printing itself to perform our academical studies, to perform our literature studies. So these four inventions is the biggest achievements that China has got a long time ago. But that was since ancient times, long time ago. But what about now, in present days? What did they actually do? What did the China do in terms of technological advancement? It is on my next slide. Right now, because it is information and technological era, there are actually mainly five things that the China actually do, and these five things that they do, these five things that they establish and that they improve and that they research is being and will become the main features of our world in the future. The first one is 5G wireless technology. China has become one of the countries that have applied 5G wireless technology in some parts of its territory. The second one is artificial intelligence. The third one is the usage of big data. The third one is financial technology, as we can see through the financial platforms such as Alibaba, which has become one of the largest e-commerce platform around the world. And the medical and biotechnology advancement is also the most prominent one in this era. And by using and by utilizing these five factors, the five components, China itself has fight along along many stakeholders in their country to fight the COVID-19 itself. How do they actually do it? How do they actually use and utilize these five factors, these five items in dealing with COVID-19? What did they actually do? Then I will explain it. Okay, next. Okay, next. So other than the government the government policies, other than the government's rules, other than the what the governments actually implement in fighting against COVID-19, but also the interaction, the relationship between the major rules of between the Chinese platform itself, it plays a great role in dealing with COVID-19. But how do they actually do it? But how do they do it in terms of in the general concept? There are four items. The first one is they create a community and share information within that. As we know, Chinese use many social media functions as well. For example, like Weibo, WeChat, QQ, and some other things. They use them to group themselves into several communities according to where they live. And in that small community, they share any kind of information that they knew about this disease itself, about the pandemic, about the COVID-19 itself. So the society, the citizens will keep up to date to any kind of information regarding COVID-19, regarding how to treat COVID, how to deal with COVID-19 from the government and the government's official announcement and etc. The second one is fight for trust, especially and in this era of data secrecy, data and data transparency, there needs to be trust between the government and between the citizens itself. So by utilizing the Chinese platform, it could gain more trust for the government from the citizens itself. The second one is to support social welfare of the citizens through the usage of applications like mobile apps, such as we call it Meituan or the Meituan Waimai or the other things that they provide some facilities so that the citizens could order food online without even having any actual physical interaction with people, so they could still get what they need and they could still be safe from the pandemic of COVID-19 itself. And the fourth one and the last one is to help ecosystem partners and workers. As we may know right now, there are one terms that has been related with work in the COVID-19 pandemic era, which is work from home or work remotely from your home, working online from your home. So the China has been implemented this kind of work environment since the outbreak of the disease itself. So they told all of the workers, all of the government officials, most of them, to work in their home instead, coming to the office to reduce the infection of COVID-19. Okay, next. Now, that's the general things that they do. That's the general main points that they do. But exactly in terms of science and technology, what did they actually do? Mainly, there are four things that is related with usage of or utilizing of the technology in dealing with COVID-19. The first one is real-time screening. It used an AI-powered non-contact infrared sensor system that provides users with fast multi-person temperature monitoring. They can quickly detect a person if they are suspected of having a fever, which is one of the many symptoms in the coronavirus infection or in the COVID-19 infection. As we can see in this picture, it is the usage of the real-time screening machine in one of the stations in Beijing, and it could detect up to 200 people in 1 minute without even disturbing the people's traffic itself. So with this real-time screening, the officer itself could get an actual condition of the people passing by, whether they have a high fever or not. If they have a high fever, then they will be separated from the others and they will be tested for another for further testing if whether they have COVID-19 or not. The next one. The second one is the automating healthcare. Using AI or artificial intelligence to they can quickly detect and identify the pneumonic lesions while providing quantitative assessment for diagnosis information, including the number, volume, and proportion of the pneumonic lesions. As we know, since COVID-19 itself is attacking our respiratory system, so the appearance of pneumonic lesions has been one of the diagnosis criteria to detect whether this person have a problems in the respiratory tract or not. If the person respiratory tract is troubled, then they will be further assessed whether they have COVID-19 or not. As we can see in this picture, this is the CT imaging analysis powered by Baidu's open source deep learning platform. This is the first time in China that has been used in one of the hospital there to deal with the patient that is suspected as having COVID-19. So they use CT scan to detect whether CT scan combined with artificial intelligence to analyze the data of the patient's condition, whether they really are having COVID-19 or not. And this is the China's first open source AI model for pneumonic CT imaging. The third one, next. The third one is, and the most prominent one that we also use, and after the COVID-19 become a global pandemic, it is globally used, is the big data tracking by using AI-powered mapping systems to identify the flow of travel across high-risk areas using Baidu Maps. So for those of you who are wondering what is Baidu, Baidu is one of the biggest technology company in China. So in around the world, we have Google, and Google like conquers everything related to technology. But in China, since Google is banned, so they use Baidu instead. And Baidu is one of the conqueror or emperor of technology in China. So using Baidu Maps, and one of their features is Baidu Maps, the same as Google Maps, similar to that, it's like the Chinese version of the Google Maps. Migration big data platform, the population movements come from Wuhan can broadly track the early spread of the coronavirus. So by using this air-powered COVID-19 viral impact tracking, we could track which areas is safe, which area has been infected by COVID-19, which areas is a green area, it's a safe zone or a red zone, and this all happened actually in real time. So they every day they always updated the data, they always updated the tracking map itself. The next one. And the fourth one is the usage of autonomous vehicle. The usage of autonomous vehicle to transport food, as well as reducing human-to-human physical contact in order to prevent COVID-19 infection. And with the daily deliveries, this initiative is helping feed over 100 frontline staff members as they work to treat growing patient base. So in the hospital, in one or two, hospitals in Beijing, since they need to reduce the physical contact with human-to-human physical contact, they need to reduce that. So in order to deliver food, in order to maintain the healthy and the warmth of the food they deliver, they use this autonomous vehicle. And as you can see, I don't know if you can read the Chinese character there, but it is stated xianzuo reshi. It means that the food is warm and just currently cooked. So they transport fresh and warm food through this vehicle in the hospitals for the health professionals there, since they couldn't leave their post, since they couldn't have any physical contact with other humans other than outside the hospital. Okay, now these are the four things related to the utilizing of science and technology in China to deal with COVID-19. Now, what lessons can we really learn from the China's experience in dealing with COVID-19? Mainly, there are four items that I would like to share with you. Next. Okay, you can skip to the next. mainly there are four items. The first one is in dealing with COVID-19, we need to contain the spread of the infection itself. So by locking down some of the red zones, so-called red zones, by using a lockdown strategy is one of the strategy that they use to contain the spread of COVID-19. The second one is keep informed by utilizing the social media, by utilizing the AI tracking map. The people could still get informed about the current and actual condition of the pandemic itself in the country. The third one is to ensure the quality of life. So even though they couldn't go anywhere, even though they couldn't have a physical contact with any other person outside, but the usage of technology in China still ensured them to still have a life full of qualities, to still have full of meaning by using the mobile apps or by using other media platforms to still keep in touch with the people they love, to still keep in touch with the work they need to do, and to reignite the productivity. It is related to the third one because no matter how we do, no matter what kind of situation we're in, we need to keep productive, no matter whether it's outside or staying inside or in lockdown, not lockdown, we still need to keep productive. And by using the technology, we could still keep productive even though we didn't go anywhere, such as the webinar that was being organized right now is one of the example, a simple, very, very simple example of utilizing the technology to keep our productivity in check. And for the last one, I would like to share a quote from one of the most prominent figure in China. Could you skip to the next slide? Which is Jack Ma, which is one of the founder of Alibaba, the one of the biggest e-commerce in China and as well as in the world. He said that, "I believe it's not a technology that changed the world. It is the dream behind the technology that changed the world." So I hope that with the usage and utilizing of technology, whether it is in the context of fighting COVID-19 pandemic or in the context of our daily life or in the context of our work life, we will not forget that the technology is not the one who shaped us, but we are the one who shaped the technology in the way we wanted it to be, in the way we needed it to be. So that's all I can share in this session. Hope you guys could get some useful information and knowledge. I apologize if there is some missing in my presentation, and I would like to end it and this presentation with greatest gratitude for the chance that was given to me to share this with you. Thank you, and I will give it back to the moderator.
Thank you, Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar, for delivering the talk. That was very impressive presentation. I would like to express some of the key points that we have heard. First of all, it is clear that China has valuable lessons for the world in how to fight COVID-19. And regarding our topics, how China utilizes the science and technology, it is important also to highlight that a nation should use any available technologies to overcome this pandemic, especially the use of AI-powered technologies. For example, the real-time screening, automating healthcare system, which can rapidly detect and identify the pneumonic lesions, for example. And also, it's important to use big data tracking technology to track the spread of the coronavirus. And this utilization of autonomous vehicle also that can reduce human-to-human interaction should also be considered. This very, very great lesson that we can take from China. Thank you very much, Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar, to share this very interesting information. And next, we will move to our second speaker, Mr. Randy Fernanda, to deliver his presentation. And again, as a reminder, there will be a question and answer session and discussion with the speakers after the presentation. And for those who have question, again, please write your name and your country or region, followed by your question. And of course, we will choose the best question from the audience for the speakers to answer. I ask you to give full attention also to Mr. Randy Fernanda and help me in welcoming him to the stage. Mr. Randy Fernanda, the stage is yours.
Okay. Thank you very much for the chance given to me, Mr. Hilmi Al-Farouqi. It's my pleasure to involve in this event regarding how Indonesia can follow or get information to fight COVID-19. And also it's my pleasure to share the information related what India did to fight or to combat COVID-19. So this is my topic, India Combat COVID-19, entitled Let Dengue Be Our Bad Dengue Be. So means that we will fight and we will grow. Everyone knows that the first case of COVID-19 pandemic in India was reported on 30 January 2020, and it's originating from China. And related to that, so many regulations that made by the Indian government. And in the latest news, they implement national lockdown. Compared with Indonesia, Indonesia was implement large-scale social distancing. It's in the President of Indonesia issued government regulation number 21/2020 on large-scale social distancing. Meanwhile, India implement national lockdown, means that totally everything must close and lock down. And if you see in the next slide, the coronavirus cases in India nowadays become the fourth highest number in the world after Russia, Brazil, and the United States. The question is why it becomes the fourth highest number, since India was locked down almost 3 months. Can you imagine India as a developing countries, they implement national lockdown almost more than 3 months, and now it's goes to in the 4th month. So if we see in the case, the coronavirus cases in India per day, now for today is almost 15,000 people was infected. And now the total was confirmed is also almost 500,000 people was infected. But if we see from the total or the numbers of person who was recovered, it almost more than 50% was recovered from COVID-19. So in the next slide, please. Like I have told you before, India was implement a national lockdown. So it divided into some categories. It caused lockdown 1.0, lockdown 2.0, 3.0, 4.0, and the last one, we say lockdown 5.0, or mostly people in India say unlock 1.0. So the national lockdown was started on 24 March until now. So more than 3 months was India implement national lockdown. And if you see on the slide also, now they implement unlock 1.0, means that the Prime Minister ordered a lockdown 5.0 and implement lockdown limited to containment. So it's like in Indonesia, they put large scale restrictions. So they do a lot of restriction related to what people should do and what people should not do. And this is the point what can allow or prohibit it in India. You can read in my slide. Next, there is a phenomenon which happened in India and is also famous in Indonesia. For example, a lot of in newspaper related to migrant workers. So as we know that there are India as a biggest population, the third biggest population in the world, they have 1.3 billion people, and there is 400 million migrant workers, you know, like they need to earn the money by having a daily works. So if the government implement national lockdown, so means that they didn't have any utilized, there is no tools to get or to earn the money. So therefore, mostly the migrant worker, they want to go back to their home. Unfortunately, because the regulation of the government, or mostly people say this is like the brutality of decision made by the Indian government, because by implement national lockdown at that time, there are 400 million people want to go home, there is no public transportation. And by having social gathering in public transportation, like in the metro station or in train, so the increase of the number of infected COVID-19 also become higher than before. And if you see also in the next slide, there is some police in India. No, I mean in the next pictures, there is a police in India also in the previous, please. There is a police personnel was checking many people, please in the previous. Yeah, there is a police personnel checking motorists during the lockdown. So if you go out from your home, so many people bring their stick to beat you. So this is also common in Indonesia and become phenomenal because how strict they are in implement the policy that made by the government. And also in the third pictures, if you see in the third pictures, there is so many immigrant worker tech work from the rural area to urban, from urban area to rural area or to their home. Can you imagine, because there is no public transportation, most many migrant worker tech work, like if I compare like from Lampung to Jambi or even like from Jakarta to East Java. So it's very it's very tired because you must take a walk, and this is because of mostly people say this is the brutality of the policy that made by the Indian government. But uniquely, if you see also in the fourth pictures, when the government opened for liquid shop, there is very huge people queue to get the liquors. So can you imagine the Indians people also, they more prefer to drink liquors or to drink an alcohol than fight with COVID-19. So means that if they didn't implement this regulation, maybe India become the highest was infected in COVID-19. So I think in my perspective related to the impact what Indian policy did is they also become the 443 rank in the world if we talk the country who was infected in COVID-19 related to the per capita, because the number of people in India is 1.3 billion. And remember, India is as a developing country. Next. So what India should do to combat COVID-19? So this is the thing that they do. This is also almost same with what Indonesia also did. They launched a COVID-19 test car or bus. So they launched so many COVID-19 test bus in around India. And as the information, they implement more than almost 200 people in a day. They can do a test for COVID-19. And also they use for drone to sanitize in some area or in sensitive area. Next. Okay. This is also what India did. Like they provide lab shift, RT or PCR machine and manpower. And also they have 612 total testing lab. And also they strengthen the technology by using CSR National Aerospace Laboratorium. And next, please. So I want to share with this part. India, they implement, as we know that if we talk about China, China mostly at that time was produce about hardware. Meanwhile, in India, they produce about software. So Narendra Modi, as the Prime Minister of India in 2015, they launched IMED program. So it means that the Indian government helped the entrepreneur to build 1 million mobile app startup. So by having this, so in the quote from the Narendra Modi, he said that by I see the startup, technology and innovation as exciting and effective instrument for India's transformation. So they believe that the technology can transform their country much better than before. And if you see in the big basket, they have a big basket in this is as the largest online supermarket. So when the government implement national lockdown, so we have a difficulties how to get the groceries. Meanwhile, in India, it's long time they have e-commerce. So by having an e-commerce, especially in supermarket, they can provide the groceries. So people can buy everything by online. So they don't have to go out. And Big Basket also, the price is even sometimes much cheaper than if you go to the traditional market. So if you go to the traditional market, compare with the Big Basket, sometimes in some cases, the price is much cheaper than in traditional market. And also we see that in Big Basket or in some platform online, there are 35% higher than in the previous months from April. So if we see the order volume in May, 35% higher than in April. So I think this is also as a key factors how India combat with COVID-19. Next. And the second one is in digital payment. If we see in India, if you go to even like in the grassroots, if you go to the street food, or even if you want to buy, like in Indonesia, you want to buy gorengan, or even you want to buy vegetable or groceries in traditional market. So you don't have to bring a cash, because mostly people in the street area or even like in the traditional market, they use a digital payment. And in India, the first or the highest use of digital payment called as Paytm. So me, myself, who stay in India, also use this, because it's very help. Because if you want to use any public transportation, if you want to buy like gorengan in India or in any street food in India, you can use digital payment. Therefore, there is no physical contact between each other. So if you go to India, you don't have to use physical contact, because every online transaction appears in India. Next. And also, this is was also can be implemented by Indonesian government. So in India, they have DigiLocker or also Adat application. Adat is like in Indonesia EKTP, or in mostly now very famous about DigiLocker. So if you download this app, you can use this app. This app also give storage 1 GB, so you can upload all your document, your private document. And it can be used in any places. So if you go to the airport, or if you use a train, or if you were stopped by police and asked by ask your driving license, so you just show this application, show your ID card, show your in India Aadhaar card, or you can use your SIM card. So it can be as same as a physical document. So you don't need to bring, you know, your very huge in wallet. So only by using the smartphone, you can use Indian's document. And also the difference between Aadhaar card and also EKTP. If in EKTP, if you see there is a, they classify into some category. For example, like me in Lampung, the number of EKTP is 18. And also if I stay in North Lampung, the number is 03. Meanwhile, so means that there is the number, the classified number for every province, every country, every region, or in every district. Meanwhile, in Aadhaar card, no. This is very unique number. They not classify on that. They very unique. So one person only have one. You cannot predict what kind of number you have. But in Indonesia, you can predict your number based on your district and also your date of birth. Next. And also in the healthcare, as we know, India also have a very cheap, especially in the medicine, also in medical sectors. And also in the next thing, India also have Ayurvedic. So they not only have yoga, but also they have Ayurvedic, where the government very serious with this thing. Therefore, they make the Ministry of Ayush. This ministry was focused on how to analyze related to the traditional medicine in from India. So they very learn how the medicine, the traditional medicine Ayurvedic, to develop in India. And if we see also there is ASHA application. This is for the mental health. And for example, also they have answer robotic. This is for in the especially in the hospital. So this is how to kill some infection in the room of hospital. So you don't need to go to clean the room. So by using this robotic system, you just disinfect the room. And also the government launched feedback call center on COVID-19 public grievance and providing counseling of doctor and nurse then psychological of support. Next. In education part, as we know that in Indonesia they didn't implement national exam. Meanwhile, in India they still do national examination. Therefore, the government launched National Test Abash. National Test Abash, this is as the similarity of national exam. So you can learn every subject study by using this app. And this is also Techmock test on their newly launched. So this is similar with the national exam that will be held by Indian's government later. So you don't need, if you cannot go to the Indonesia institution of education, you can use this app, you can learn by yourself. And this is can be done by offline. So you don't need to internet. So you just download it and you can see, you can use it in offline. Next. And this is also was well known in India. The government launched Arogya Setu application. This is how to track the COVID-19, like what India, what in China did. So they use the big data and everything. So do I in India. By using this application, they can classify some area in India, whether this is the red zone, orange zones, or green zones. So by having this zone, the government can make a decision. So every government in state, they launch a COVID-19 war room. For example, like in India, they launch also the application. So this is how to classify whether the area is how to, you know, like to classify the places, like is it possible to open the place or not? Is it possible to track a person who have COVID-19 or not and everything. Next. And also if some Indian people, some Indian or foreign still stranded in state, they provide A-Pass movement. So by providing A-Pass movement, people from other state to move to another state by using this application, they can move to other state, to another state, especially for a migrant worker or for the tourists who travel to other state. So this is very help also to minimize the spread of COVID-19. Next. And nowadays, the government of India also was launched the drug in India for fight the COVID-19. The name is Fabiflu. So first COVID-19 drug in India has been launched, and the name is Fabiflu. This is was launched Saturday by Glenmark Pharmaceutical from Mumbai. And this is also very cheap, not very expensive, because for one tablet is only 20,000 rupiah. So in India, they can provide a generic medicine, so every people can use the drugs, and this Fabiflu is for the difficult cases. And also in India they have Ayurveda, so by using this Ayurveda they can increase the immune system in Indian people. So mostly they have strengthened their body. That's why mostly Ayurveda was learned by the Ministry of Ayush and how to spread in the world the medicine of Ayurveda. And the third is they have yoga. So they train almost 1,000 people, instructors. Okay, next. I do really sorry for the mistake. I think there is a problem with my connectivity. Next. Okay, so by implementing everything, by implementing all the strategy, nowadays, if you see the COVID-19 recovery rate is more than 50%. The number is 54.13% based on the government side. So I do really recommend this what India did to fight or to combat COVID-19. And for the inspirational figures, next, in my perspective is Narendra Modi and also APJ Abdul Kalam. Please next. Okay, next. Yeah, this is the most famous figures in India, APJ Abdul Kalam. And also Narendra Modi, how they can increase the technologies aspect. APJ Abdul Kalam, especially related to nuclear and also satellite and everything. Meanwhile, Narendra Modi as the Prime Minister, they implement a very good policy to strengthen the India in the much better in the next way, in the next step. And that's all from me. Thank you very much. I do really hope that you can use this information to combat COVID-19. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Randy Fernanda, for delivering the talk. That was also a very nice presentation. Before we move to the next session, I would like to express also some of the key points that we have learned from Mr. Randy Fernanda. It is obvious that the Indian people and government still struggling to fight this pandemic, but fortunately, the recovery rate now almost 60%. Indeed, we still can learn from India to mitigate this pandemic. Since, in my understanding also, as the speakers also addressed, India is also very advanced in science and technology. As I remember, in the World Cup 2000 or something, India, one of the company from India, Mahindra Satyam, they won the tender for the informational technology during the World Cup. And in addition, I'm triggered and I'm also impressed that India also uses drone technology to sanitize the sensitive areas. And also the use of online markets and digital payment would really help the spread, would really help to stop the spread of the coronavirus. And also optimizing the use of smartphones, for example, to use it and install it with some apps that can be used to store highly credential information and documents. And finally, to sanitize the rooms or spots using robot technology is also very attractive and very effective. Again, it was very nice to learn from Mr. Randy Fernanda and also Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar as well. However, unfortunately, the time is up. Without waiting any longer, I will give the next time for Mr. Francesco Reddy Carocaro to guide our next speakers. Mr. Reddy, time is yours.
Yeah, thank you, my colleague, Mr. Hilmi, for the stage. The second session will be delivered third speaker, Mr. Ali Ihsan Rupali from Perpika, South Korea. And the fourth speaker, Mr. Felito Arnusau from Permira, Russia. Yeah. Before starting, let me introduce myself. My name is Reddy. I'm master students in Russia, and I'm head of Energy Commission of Croatia. If you have a question, just write in box chat, and don't forget write down your name, your country, or your religion. And now we will move to our third speaker, Mr. Ali. Are you ready, Mr. Ali?
Okay, thank you. Ready, Mr. Ready.
To be short on the time, the state belongs to you, Mr. Ali.
Okay, thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh, everyone. Good afternoon, Korean time. And first of all, I would like to show my gratitude to friends and all the organizers that holding this very good event, international event of the International Student Association Alliance. And yep, in this occasion, I would like to share some ideas and experience we have from South Korea in combating the COVID-19. Okay, let me share my screen first. Okay, let's check. So yeah. So in this occasion, I would like to. This is the contents that I will deliver. So the first, I will explain briefly about the condition of the Korea today, and the second one will be mostly the strategy to flattening the curve of the coronavirus pandemic here in Korea, and also in the end, I would like to put something that we have done for Indonesian people here. And also, but in the end, I will like to explain you the conclusion and reference. So yeah, the Korea today, as you can see from the graph, the active case is pretty low. It is around 1,300. And it's been low for about 1 month, right? From May. But in the end of the May, the graph or the active case start to emerge again. It means the second wave start to happening. So yeah, we even though we have a very stable condition at the moment, but we need to be careful as well. Yep. And nowadays, the recent condition in Korea, most of the active case are located in city of Seoul, Incheon, and Gyeonggi province, also in Daejeon. So as you can see, during the end of the April, the most case were the imported case, which is the imported means the positive coronavirus coming from the outside region of the Korea. So foreigner coming to Korea, they carry the coronavirus. So that's why, as you can see, the figure here, the imported case now is almost 30% among the active cases of coronavirus. And the next will be the strategy to flattening the curve. Yeah. So in the early stage, even though in the early stage of the spread of the coronavirus, we can go back to the end of the January, if I'm not mistaken, the first case of the coronavirus in Korea. Fortunately, the Korea already preparing for developing the testing kit for the coronavirus COVID-19, and fortunately, it was done before the outbreak happens in Daegu, in the city of Daegu, in the end of the February. So by the time of the outbreak happened, the government and the healthcare already prepared for testing the people of the coronavirus suspect. And by using this testing kit, massive testing, the government were able to map the region which have severe coronavirus condition and the green area and so on. So then they can especially managing the the availability of the mask during the outbreak. So it was very good strategy, I think. And as you can see in the figure, on the left side is the sample of the one of the testing kit provided by Seegene. And on the right, it is the photograph of the team developing this testing kit. And the second one, so the developing the testing kit is not the only way to flatten the curve. It is not enough. So the second stage is to employ the smart quarantine information system. So as you can see, the KCDC stands for the Korea Center for Disease and Control and Prevention. Is the main brain to control the quarantine information system in the whole Korea. As you can see, it is connected to Ministry of Justice, and it also is connected to Ministry of Foreign Affairs, also to National Quarantine Station, which include the airport and the terminal, and it also connected to the healthcare facility. So everything is connected here, and this makes the strategy to flatten the curve of coronavirus in Korea quite effective, because as a common people, we didn't experience that the low availability of the mask, for example, because the government was able to maintain the condition of the mask in the market, and also they were able to maintain the number of the suspected. And so that's why this smart quarantine system is very efficient. And as you may wonder why Korea find this kind of strategy, actually they already employ this smart quarantine information long before the coronavirus happened in Korea. So they already implemented this after the SARS and MERS pandemic in 2015. So by learning from that pandemic, they managed to employ the quarantine information to restrict the moving of the people, of the suspected people, so then the spread of the coronavirus can be controlled. Okay, and the next, and the next one will be mobile phone technology data for contact tracing. The contact tracing is very important, especially during the early stage, because we don't have enough information about the coronavirus properties itself. So in that case, tracing the contact of the suspected people will be highly effective to prevent the spread of the coronavirus even further. So as you can see on the left side here, the strategy to contact tracing, the first one is the investigation. The people who suspected to be positive coronavirus will be interviewed, and they will, for example, fill some form. And from that investigation, the government or the health professional over there will assess the risk level of the people. And from after that, they can classify they have done, and which people, which region they have contacted previously. So after that, they employ the contact management. Depends on the classification. It is classified as two. As you can see, the first one is the move restriction, and the second one is the monitoring. And the tracing is also available in the mobile apps. As you can see, there is a Corona map available on the web. And as you can see from the map, that there will be several dots here. The red means there are some positive coronavirus cases in that region. So by looking at this one, people can individually manage to avoid that place. So then they can avoid the COVID-19. And we also get a lot of messages every day, daily messages from the government about the condition of the city nearby. So we get informed very well, and that is very effective in order to prevent the spread of the coronavirus. So then people will understand what they do. People will understand that they cannot go to the public shopping, for example, too much, and they cannot go to the, for example, to the school or the campus, because there are so high potential to get infected in that area. And for the foreigner coming to Korea, they will be informed about the self-health check mobile apps, especially during the second wave where the imported case is the most prominent. As you can see, especially for students during March or April, I got several news from our friend that they are forced to install some application which they don't know. However, this application is for the self-health check mobile apps, and from the apps you can check your condition and you can report your condition daily. And actually, the government will contact you daily also, and even more frequent. So then they can understand what's your condition, what's your exact condition in that day, and to prevent the spread of the coronavirus. Yep, the fourth stage or the fourth step to flattening the curve is basically using the technology of, in this case, AI. This AI, artificial intelligence, is used to improve the diagnosis efficiency and patient classification. Yep, the first one is introduced by Seegene, as I mentioned previously, that they use the artificial intelligence to speed up the development of the making the test kits of the COVID-19. So then they can finish the work 2 weeks, within the 2 weeks. And fortunately, it was just before the outbreak in the Daegu city. So it is very fortunate for us. And there are several organizations also, VUNO, using the X-ray with the artificial intelligence to classify the disease of the people. And also GLK inspection, similar to VUNO here, I think, using the AI to classify the lung of the suspected corona people. And interestingly, the Daegu city is becoming the smart city nowadays. They use a lot of data of the public, of the people on the city, so then they can manage to constrict the spread of the coronavirus by using the data from the people. And as you can see, Daegu city is the first city of the outbreak in Korea, but using the technology they have, they were able to manage the situation, and in the end we are now in a stable state or stable condition. And in terms of improving or developing the drugs, some organization in Korea also, or some research center in Korea, also use AI and deep learning to predict the interaction of drug protein, and from that we can propose the candidate medicine, such as medicine for HIV virus, and we can also propose for the COVID-19 as well. And also the Arontir here, developing the platform to find the candidate substance to treat coronavirus more quickly. So basically, they employ the artificial intelligence technology to speed up the development of the drugs in order to combat the coronavirus. And yep, the fifth one, maybe the last one for the strategy, I think, from the Korea perspective, the mobile apps for information sharing. Yeah, it's similar to what I've mentioned previously about the tracing, the contact tracing by using the mobile apps. However, in this case, some company, they developed the mass app service process. As you can see on the right, you can check the availability of the mass using the map, in this case, the Naver map. So whenever you have few number of map available, so you can check to the map and find the nearest location at which you can find the map available. And also the price of the map of the mass is also quite stable. There is no such increasing of the price or forth. So it is very good. And the last, I would like to explain you also about the what we Indonesian here do or did during the COVID-19 pandemic. As you can see, we, the Indonesian Student Association in Korea, also closely work with the Embassy of Indonesia in Seoul. And on the left side here, as you can see, we publish the number, our mobile number, to the public, so then people will contact us about everything regarding the coronavirus. And by using this publication of the mobile phone number, they were get informed directly, and also they were get calm quickly, because sometimes when you get bad news about the COVID-19, you get excited and you get anxiety, right? So by calling this number, and you get informed about the current condition and what to do, it will help you to be better. And then we also have a lot of meetings and regular meetings with our ambassador. I can say it is about twice in a month, I think. So using this technology of communication in this era, we can discuss about the current situation, about the coronavirus, and also about the you can check in the news that our neighbor country in North Korea is in a hot situation at the moment. So we talk about our situation in Korea with our ambassador very frequently, and it helped us to keep calm and get informed very good. And this is the conclusion, I think. Even though we are paying too much tuition to learn the COVID-19, yeah, we learn a lot about the AI and about the, how to develop the test kit and everything. We should together make best effort to turn the crisis into opportunity, because the tragedy will end soon or later. As you can see, there are several countries in the world that get the tragedy early, like China or Korea. Now they are now playing on the upper hand, because they can turn the opportunity, the crisis, into the opportunity. For example, by using the test kit they have developed, they can now export it to the countries which need, and so on. And the second one, we can escape from the past, but we can build the future by managing the present. Yes. And the third, to rise up from the bottom, I think we can use the ICT or the cutting edge technology and elevate relationship among people, society, and nation. Because even though we tried our best to fight COVID-19 by using test kit and, for example, and using the technology, AI technology, however, the main role is the vaccine, and the vaccine is still not available nowadays. So by using the ICT technology, we can help people get connected one another, because we cannot have the social life like before, where we can chat to a lot of people in mass gather. So yeah, cutting edge technology will highly important nowadays to connect people when we just stay at home during the time we stay at home. So I think that's all from me. Thank you. This is the reference, and stay safe and stay healthy. I will give it back to the moderator.
Thank you, Mr. Ali, for your presentation. It's very nice, I think. Before moving to next speaker, I express four key points from Mr. Ali. How the strategy of South Korea for flattening the curve are, the first, phase development testing kit, massive testing, and the second, smart quarantine information system. The third, mobile phone technology data for contact tracing and information sharing. Availability marks and price too, I think. And the fourth, implementing artificial intelligence for improving diagnosis efficiency and patient classification. And for Indonesians in South Korea, Indonesia's ambassador shares the contact number for the more information. Okay, now we move to fourth our speaker, Mr. Arnold Song. Once more, if you have time, if you have question, just write in box chat. Don't forget to write down your name, your country or your region. And I think the presentation will be held on Bahasa. Hello, Bung Ferlito.
Siap, selamat sore.
Siapkan untuk mempresentasikan?
Siap.
Oke, kalau begitu waktu dan tempatnya, stage-nya saya persilakan untuk Bung Ferlito.
Oke, baik. Baik, sebelumnya saya sampaikan selamat siang waktu Moskow. Sekarang masih jam 2 siang. Dan juga berbeda dengan beberapa pembicara sebelumnya, saya akan membawakan ini dalam bahasa Indonesia. Oke, jadi mungkin saya ingin mempresentasikan, saya akan share screen dulu. Oke. Sip. Oke. Jadi sebelumnya perkenalkan nama saya Ferlito Arnold Sau, saya Ketua Permira Rusia, Perhimpunan Mahasiswa Indonesia di Rusia. Jadi sesuai tema yang diberikan adalah Ambassador and Young Leadership. Jadi saya ingin menjelaskan dulu mengenai apa sih yang dilakukan oleh pemerintah Rusia. Kemudian selanjutnya apa sih yang dapat kita lakukan sebagai anak Indonesia atau penerus generasi Indonesia yang ada di luar negeri. Oke, jadi yang pertama mengenai kondisi di Rusia. Jadi mungkin saya ingin kembali ke belakang sedikit, di mana pada tanggal 2 sampai tanggal 8 itu Rusia, begitu informasi mengenai coronavirus terjadi di dunia, mereka mulai membatasi perlahan. Mulai dari pembatasan khusus warga negara Cina, hingga akhirnya pembatasan mulai ke warga negara yang Spanyol dan lain-lain, hingga akhirnya menyeluruh perbatasan itu ditutup. Nah, jadi itu semua dimulai pada tanggal 2 sampai tanggal 8 Februari lalu. Kemudian, di tanggal 1 sampai tanggal 7 Maret, kalau dapat dilihat di layar, Rusia has temporarily banned the export of medical masks, gloves, bandage, and protective sheets. Artinya, semua peralatan, bisa dibilang peralatan medis, itu dibatasi untuk pengeksporan. Artinya, memang pemerintah di sini, mereka mengutamakan agar supaya mencukupi dulu, karena mereka nggak tahu ke depannya itu bagaimana, apakah akan ada pertambahan atau akan ada apa, itu mereka nggak tahu. Jadi mereka yang penting, mereka simpan dan mereka siapkan itu. Kemudian juga untuk kendaraan-kendaraan di Moskow, terutama untuk kereta bawah tanah, pada tanggal segitu mulai melaksanakan random check, di mana orang akan diperiksa suhunya. Karena waktu itu seperti yang kita tahu, pada awal-awal coronavirus beredar di dunia, mulai ada ciri-ciri bahwa akan orang di atas 37 derajat dan lain-lain. Nah, oleh karena itu, mereka sudah mulai. Walaupun pada tanggal-tanggal segitu itu, seingat saya, masih jumlahnya masih sedikit itu di Rusia. Kalau nggak salah, masih atau belum ada barangkali. Kalau dapat dilihat di grafik, 28 Maret baru mulai. Jadi itu mereka betul-betul sudah mulai, bahkan saat negara lain yang sudah mulai coronavirus, tapi negaranya belum, tapi mereka sudah mulai itu. Kemudian pada tanggal 16 Maret, barulah mulai diwacanakan untuk penutupan sekolah dan universitas. Jadi, sama halnya, seperti tadi random check, saat jumlah mahasiswa di Indonesia, mahasiswa di Rusia yang entah mahasiswa ataupun penyebaran coronavirus masih belum terlalu banyak di Rusia, mereka sudah mengupayakan untuk meniadakan atau melaksanakan kelas jarak jauh. Kemudian yang saya ingin, ada juga di 18 Maret, di mana Russian prisoners, penjara Rusia, siswa dan personel militer akan memproduksi peralatan medis seperti masker dan peralatan lainnya untuk menghadapi coronavirus. Untuk menghadapi. Jadi waktu itu belum coronavirus sudah menyebar, tapi mereka sudah mempersiapkan itu. Oke, mungkin kalau untuk saat ini poin-poinnya bisa dapat dulu ya. Dan pada tanggal 28 Maret, barulah secara masif, secara luas, border Rusia ditutup. Oke, mungkin teman-teman sudah bisa dapat gambarannya mengenai apa sih yang ingin saya sampaikan. Kemudian kalau teman-teman lihat di grafik sini, hal-hal yang dilakukan itu, begitu border ditutup, begitu universitas di jarak jauh kan, mulai tes masif. Mulai dari tanggal 28 Maret, seingat saya 2 orang, kemudian bertambah, sampai puncaknya pada tanggal 11 Mei. Nah, di situ, pada tanggal 11 Mei, akhirnya puncaknya dan perlahan sudah mulai menurun lagi. Kemudian, mungkin saya ingin kembali pada poin tadi. Yang ingin dipelajari, apa sih yang sebenarnya bisa kita terapkan untuk di Indonesia? Pertama, mungkin saat apabila kita akan menghadapi sebuah pandemi atau menghadapi sebuah situasi nantinya, kita baiknya memikirkan dulu matang-matang. Apa sih yang kira-kira akan terjadi? Kira-kira stok kita tuh cukup nggak? Itu yang kayaknya yang harus dipertimbangkan untuk kita ini ke depannya. Karena kita, bagaimanapun kita yang akan generasi kita, anak-anak Indonesia ini yang akan pulang kembali ke Indonesia dan akan membangun Indonesia, kitalah yang akan belajar dari ini semua, dari negara-negara tadi, dari ini. Jadi ke depannya kalau misalnya kita menjadi pejabat atau menjadi apapun itu, silakan belajar dari masa lalu ini, belajar dari saat ini, belajar dari negara-negara lain saat ini, apa yang terjadi di negara-negara itu. Mulai perhatikan stok. Kemudian juga mulai perhatikan masalah bagaimana sih peningkatan atau pemanfaatan untuk pemproduksian medis, alat-alat medis. Kita kan nggak mungkin cuma memerintahkan perusahaan-perusahaan medis untuk ayo buat secepatnya, kita bisa dorong itu. Tapi bagaimana juga kita memanfaatkan sumber daya kita yang kaya. Kurang lebih seperti itu. Kemudian, apa sih yang dilakukan oleh Rusia pada saat angka-angka itu sudah naik? Jadi kalau tadi dia di grafik, ada saat pada saat pembelajaran jarak jauh dimulai, kemudian ada saat kelas pekerjaan dinonaktifkan, artinya kerja, orang nggak boleh keluar kerja, walaupun memang masih ada yang kerja. Kemudian, apa sih yang diberlakukan? Orang waktu itu sepi, orang nggak bisa keluar. Jadinya diberlakukan digital permit. Itu dibuat untuk kota Moskow. Itu khusus untuk kota Moskow. Mereka, kalau mereka ingin keluar untuk belanja atau untuk melakukan apapun itu, mereka harus membuat kartu izin. Kartu izin secara digital, yang nantinya kita harus mengisi data, beberapa data, tujuan keluar, dan lain-lain. Dan itu yang kita gunakan untuk keluar. Pada saat keluar, apabila ketemu polisi, itu yang kita kasih tunjuk. Nah, jadi pada saat non-working day itu diberlakukan, pemeriksaan itu masif. Jadi bukan random, tapi masif. Jadi kita butuhkan ini untuk supaya tidak didenda. Nah, itu mungkin yang dapat kita pelajari dari teknologi sini. Yaitu, bukan berarti begitu tutup, langsung semua aktivitas berhenti. Enggak, kita bisa melakukan itu mungkin menggunakan digital, sistem digital begini maupun beberapa hal lainnya gitu. Kemudian juga mulai pada tanggal 19 Mei Moskow mengumumkan bahwa kapasitas tes akan ditingkatkan sampai 200.000 per hari. Kalau teman-teman lihat, angkanya ini angkanya cepat sekali naik. Angkanya cepat sekali naik dari 28 Maret sampai bulan April itu sudah 5.000-an, kemudian sampai sudah 10.000-an. Dan angka-angka itu naik karena jumlah tes yang masif. Jadi yang dapat kita pelajari dari Rusia lagi adalah jumlah tes masif. Awalnya pada saat Rusia itu terkena COVID, itu kan di daerah Irkutsk dan daerah Irkutsk dan satu daerah lainnya itu, waktu itu semua sampel dikirim ke Novosibirsk, laboratoriumnya di Novosibirsk. Kemudian, waktu angka-angka itu bertambah, waktu itu laboratorium itu cuma satu. Nah, lama-kelamaan, mereka mulai memedarkan laboratorium di berbagai sudut negara, berbagai kota di Rusia. Artinya, pemasifan tes diringi dengan pemasifan laboratorium itu. Itu yang dapat juga kita pelajari untuk Rusia ini. Dan sampai saat ini memang tesnya sudah sampai sekitar 100.000-an lebih, sudah mau sampai 200.000 kan per hari. Nah, itu mungkin yang dapat kita pelajari juga untuk untuk negara kita. Karena angka yang, kalau menurut saya pribadi, angka yang rendah bukan berarti itu sesuatu yang dapat kita dapat kita lega gitu. Enggak. Bisa saja karena angka rendah, karena tes rendah. Walaupun angka naik karena tes naik, nah kita harus berpikir lagi itu. Apa yang menyebabkan angka itu terus naik? Memang tes masif. Tapi apa sih yang membuat angka-angka itu tetap ada positif? Seharusnya kalau kita ingin berpikir baik, seharusnya angka naik, tes masif, tapi angka tetap menurun. Nah, itu baru bagus. Tapi kalau angka kita naik, tes kita naik, tapi angka juga naik, nah, itu yang harus lagi tetap diperhatikan itu. Kemudian pada tanggal 9 Juni, akhirnya Moskow menghentikan atau mungkin tidak berlakukan lagi self-isolation. Jadi yang kartu-kartu itu, kalau kita ingin naik metro, ingin naik apa, sudah tidak diberlakukan lagi. Kemudian, mungkin pada saat itu juga, pada saat transportasi itu memang berlaku untuk orang-orang yang ingin ke kota Moskow atau orang yang kerja dari luar Moskow ke dalam Moskow Oblast, kurang lebih seperti itu. Nah, kemudian apa sih yang terjadi setelah Moskow atau Rusia mulai merendahkan status self-isolation. Bukan merendahkan, tapi kayak mulai melonggarkan. Karena kalau kita lihat pada grafik tadi, angkanya sudah mulai turun. Akhir-akhir ini sudah mulai 7.000. Sudah mulai 7.000 pertambahan per hari. Itulah yang membuat Rusia sudah mulai membuka. Karena sebelumnya itu awalnya 10.000, hingga akhirnya 11.000, kemudian turun ke 8.000, kemudian 7.000, akhirnya mereka merasa, oke, ini sudah mulai, angka ini menurun. Nah, oleh karena itu, isolasi tersebut mulai dibuka. Kemudian, mungkin juga pada saat angka-angka itu naik, pada saat angka-angka itu terjadi, beberapa fasilitas, beberapa hal publik diputuskan secara langsung oleh pemerintah di sini untuk tidak dilaksanakan. Seperti acara-acara internasional, maupun beberapa kegiatan lainnya lah. Seperti parade 9 Mei. Parade 9 Mei itu kan setiap tahun ada, parade kemenangan Rusia. Karena berhasil menang melawan Nazi dulu. Nah itu, hal-hal itu yang mungkin kita perlu pelajari. Bahwa keputusan itu penting dibuat jauh hari, tapi dengan pertimbangan yang matang. Nah, mungkin gitu. Kemudian, apa sih yang terjadi setelah Rusia melonggarkan itu? Setelah melonggarkan, istilah new normal, saya pribadi tidak pernah dengar ya, atau mungkin jarang dengar, new normal Rusia. Enggak, saya jujur agak kurang dengar mengenai itu, tapi memang pelonggaran itu terjadi. Nah, apa sih yang disiapkan? Nah, yang disediakan adalah seperti, kalau gambar kuning ini, itu di setiap kereta bawah tanah, mereka menyediakan hand sanitizer spray. Jadi begitu kita kasih masuk tangan, otomatis akan dispray tangan kita. Nah, seperti itu mungkin yang dapat diterapkan di Indonesia. Mengapa? Bagaimanapun kan virus itu memang menyebar melalui droplet, saat kita tidak sadar menyentuhnya, kita pegang muka dan lain-lain. Nah, anti desinfektan itu yang bisa membantu kita untuk melalui atau tidak terkena virus itu. Nah, itu mungkin yang dapat dimasifkan di Indonesia mengenai hal-hal tersebut. Kemudian juga ada, kalau di gambar kanan bawah ini ada kamera temperatur. Jadi pada sampai saat ini temperatur suhu itu tetap ada. Jadi semua orang yang lewat akan diukur suhunya. Mungkin teknologi itu juga yang dapat diterapkan. Walaupun memang ada saya bacanya OTG kan. OTG memang nggak bisa kepantau melalui, karena memang nggak ada ciri-cirinya. Nggak ada suhu, nggak ada apa, ketahuannya kayak kalau melalui tes. Nah, walaupun memang itu nggak akan berimpact besar termometer suhu ini, tapi nggak ada salahnya. Barangkali kita bisa terapkan itu di Indonesia, termometer suhu, kamera suhu, dan lain-lain. Itu untuk menjaga setidaknya, walaupun kita nggak bisa menyaring OTG, tapi setidaknya menyaring juga yang barangkali ada yang sudah positif dan menunjukkan gejala. Mungkin seperti itu. Jadi kita nggak bisa satu hal langsung kita terapkan semua dan ingin merangkul semua OTG, positif, dan lain-lain supaya tidak terkena. Tapi kita bisa melakukan itu berdasarkan perlahan. Untuk ini, untuk yang mengetahui yang gejala, kita bisa gunakan termometer. Untuk yang bagaimana, kita bisa terapkan untuk OTG. Untuk orang yang nggak terkena atau menghindari penyebaran, kita bisa menggunakan disinfektan. Kemudian, di Rusia juga, kendaraan-kendaraan umum sudah memakai aturan jarak 1,5 meter. Jadi, di kursi itu, kursi, jeda. Kurang lebih seperti itu, supaya menghindari penyebaran itu terjadi juga. Jadi mungkin kalau teman-teman tadi berbicara mengenai sains, teknologi, dan lain-lain, mungkin untuk di Rusia sendiri, mengenai aplikasi untuk peredaran COVID maupun untuk penyebaran COVID itu, sampai saat ini sih saya belum dengar, atau mungkin tadi ada beberapa baca, cuma belum terlalu jelas gitu, dan memang belum kedengaran bahwa ada aplikasi khusus untuk melacak itu. Nah, kemudian mungkin karena itu untuk menjawab perihal bagaimana Rusia menghadapi COVID ini. Kemudian juga mungkin saya ingin informasikan bahwa pada saat itu juga pemerintah Rusia sangat langsung kembali lagi keputusan yang clear dan keputusan yang tepat untuk langsung membuat peralatan medis, untuk membuat kamera termometer dan lain-lain. Itu penting. Kemudian saya ingin lanjutnya karena ini juga langsung ke tema leadership. Apa sih yang dapat dilakukan oleh mahasiswa kita, mahasiswa Indonesia. Oh, namun sebelum itu saya ingin menambahkan lagi, bagaimana cara Rusia menyeimbangkan antara perekonomian dan sini. Jadi memang pada saat tadi teman-teman lihat Rusia menutup atau bukan kurang lebih membatasi menerapkan non-working day. Nah, pada saat itu apa yang dilakukan? Orang otomatis kan kalau dibatasi pekerjaannya, otomatis mereka nggak dapat uang. Apa sih yang dilakukan? Waktu itu awal-awal, anak keluarga dengan anak umur, kalau nggak salah 6 tahun ke bawah, akan mendapatkan uang sejumlah berapa rubel gitu. Itu sekitar, kalau nggak salah 5.000 atau 10.000. Kalau itu artinya 1 juta atau 2 juta per keluarga yang memiliki anak di bawah umur begitu. Per anak, seingat saya gitu. Kemudian baru-baru saja kemarin, walaupun sudah dibuka, tapi barusan kemarin Putin berbicara lagi bahwa untuk menyeimbangkan itu lagi, anak-anak dengan usia di bawah 16 tahun pada keluarga itu akan diberikan uang, kalau nggak salah sih 10.000 rubel. Jadi itulah bagaimana cara Rusia untuk membalance itu. Jadi memang orang supaya meredakan penyebarannya, mereka tidak mengizinkan orang untuk kerja, beberapa pekerjaan waktu itu, mereka membuat alur ekonomi tersebut supaya tetap produktivitas itu tetap jalan. Bahwa orang tetap dapat uang, mereka bisa belanja, mereka nggak mati kelaparan, kayak gitulah. Kemudian, untuk menjawab juga ada pada tor yang sudah tersedia, positif-negatifnya kembali lagi, mungkin kita bisa menerapkan disinfektan, nggak ada salahnya kita terapkan di Indonesia, mungkin saat ini sudah ada, tapi kita bisa masifkan itu, untuk mencegah penyebaran itu. Kemudian, untuk negatifnya sendiri, mungkin bagaimana ya, kepatuhan warga negara barangkali. Rusia sendiri cenderung karena ini sudah dibuka, orang pada leha-leha keluar, aturan atau himbauan untuk protokol kesehatan menggunakan masker dan sarung tangan itu kadang nggak semua orang menerapkan itu. Orang nggak pakai masker, orang kadang nggak sarung tangan, tapi yang paling terutama nggak maskeran. Nah, itu yang agak kurang untuk Rusia. Nah, bagaimana Indonesia bisa menerapkan itu, warga negara kita bisa mendukung itu, mendukung penyebaran yang saat ini masih naik, bagaimana supaya mendukungnya dengan menggunakan masker dan lain-lain. Nah, itu tetap penting untuk di Indonesia, saya rasa. Kemudian, ada juga tadi pertanyaan di ini mengenai bagaimana sih seharusnya siapa sih yang bisa menjadi potensial global leaders. Oke, kalau belajar dari Rusia, teknologi yang dilakukan oleh kami perhimpunan mahasiswa adalah, karena Rusia tersebar 17 juta kilometer kuadrat, jadi kami memiliki berbagai zona waktu yang berbeda. Jadi sejak dulu itu kami sudah rapat menggunakan Zoom dan lain-lain. Nah, hal inilah yang mungkin dapat diterapkan mulai dari sekarang, bahwa nggak semua kita harus bertemu. New normal itu memang terjadi di Indonesia. Tapi jadi mungkin kita sudah bisa memulai dengan model digital, bahwa kita bisa rapat secara online, kuliah secara online, dan lain-lain. Mungkin itu yang dapat diterapkan. Kemudian, apalagi sih yang dilakukan oleh Permira untuk membantu ini adalah membuat satgas, memberikan informasi mengenai jumlah, bukan untuk menakut-nakuti, tapi untuk memberitahu bahwa ini jumlah masih naik loh. Jadi, jaga dirimu baik-baik. Kemudian kami juga kasus, memberikan jumlah tes, dan lain-lain. Kemudian, ini penyebaran mahasiswa di 15 kota, kemudian jurusan dan total mahasiswa. Kemudian ada pertanyaan pada bagian apa yang dapat dilakukan diaspora Indonesia dalam rangka mendukung penanganan COVID di Indonesia. Yang dapat kita lakukan adalah begini, kita membuat diskusi, kita membuat webinar, kita membuat apapun itu yang setidaknya dapat membantu di Indonesia. Misalnya kayak waktu itu kami membuat kayu putih untuk membantu penyebaran corona, membantu pengurangan penyebaran corona. Kami membuat itu webinar bagaimana kami ingin mendengar sih sebenarnya new normal itu memang itu sebuah solusi atau represi. Kami membuat webinar itu supaya tidak di antara kami cuma saling bertanya toh, tapi kami langsung bertanya kepada sumbernya. Waktu itu ketuanya adalah ketua gugus, ketua tim pakar. Nah, jadi apa yang dapat dilakukan diaspora, karena kita jauh dari Indonesia, kita dapat membuat webinar, kita dapat membuat diskusi-diskusi, kita dapat menulis karya-karya ilmiah, dan lain-lain. Itu yang dapat kita lakukan sebagai mahasiswa Indonesia di luar negeri. Memanfaatkan teknologi, kita bisa berhubungan dengan profesor-profesor di Indonesia, kita dapat berhubungan dengan instansi-instansi terkait di Indonesia, kita dapat menggunakan itu. Kemudian mengapa saya menyebarkan ada jumlah mahasiswa, kemudian jurusan paling diminati, dan jumlah mahasiswa di Rusia? Kembali lagi, jumlah kami terluas, kami negara terbesar di Rusia, di dunia, Rusia. Kami tersebar, kami menggunakan teknologi itu, menggunakan Zoom. Jurusan yang paling diminati, itu maksud saya adalah, kita di Indonesia, kita mahasiswa ini memiliki ragam jurusan. Kenapa kita tidak manfaatkan itu? Anak jurusan internasional, bagaimana sih membahas jurusan internasional, membahas bagaimana public policy, bagaimana kebijakan yang dapat diusulkan untuk Indonesia, bagaimana anak kedokteran membahas kedokteran di negaranya, itu. Kemudian tentunya jenjang S1, S2, S3 itu berbeda juga. Kadang S3 akan lebih fokus kepada penulisan karya tulis ilmiah. Nah, bagaimana cara PPI atau bagaimana cara sebuah organisasi memanfaatkan itu? Yang terakhir juga mungkin mengenai bagaimana kita memutuskan untuk potensial global leaders. Untuk menjawab ini, saya sebenarnya tidak bisa jawab bahwa kita harus memilih dari CEO kah atau dari presiden, dari mana yang sebagai pemimpin. Tapi pemimpin itu berasal dari diasah. Misalnya dia masuk ke sebuah organisasi berdasarkan kegelisahan. Kegelisahan untuk, dan untuk menjawabnya, ingin membuat lebih baik. Oleh karena itu, dia masuk ke sebuah organisasi. Sama halnya dengan PPI. Kemudian, dia ingin menjadi ketua. Dia bukan jabatan atau posisi yang dia ingin dapatkan, tapi pengabdian. Nah, dan dia ingin menjadi pemimpin, dan harus menjadi pemimpin, bukan bos. Yaitu dia mendorong organisasinya. Dia bersama dengan mahasiswa-mahasiswanya. Artinya, apabila kita sebagai ketua-ketua PPI negara, ataupun apabila kita sebagai ketua organisasi, kita apabila ingin menyalurkan sesuatu, ingin membuat sesuatu dorongan, entah webinar dan lain-lain, kita juga harus turun dalam situ. Nah, mungkin itu yang dapat diterapkan untuk bagaimana cara diaspora Indonesia untuk mendorong sesuatu untuk negeri, dan juga bagaimana caranya supaya membuatnya lancar. Bukan kita cuma asal perintah, tapi kita harus bagaimana mengawasi itu, membawa itu supaya benar-benar terlaksana dan benar-benar akan sampai kepada pemerintah. Kemudian mungkin juga untuk mengenai pemimpinnya sendiri, kalau bisa harus yang emotional intelligence harus ada. Kemudian harus memiliki kerendahan hati untuk mendengar, terbuka untuk diskusi, masukan maupun kritik, kemampuan keberanian untuk memutuskan, dan juga bertanggung jawab. Itu yang dibutuhkan oleh seorang pemimpin. Jadi kalau kita ingin bilang bahwa bagaimana sih cara melihat pandangan terhadap pemimpin, kita ingin mencari seorang pemimpin yang kira-kira bisa membawa kita masa depan lebih baik, kita nggak bisa lihat itu. Tapi maksudnya kita nggak bisa bilang ini berasal dari politikus, ini berasal dari mana, nggak bisa. Kita nggak bisa bilang ini berasal dari apa ini, dari institusi atau organisasi tertentu, nggak bisa. Tapi kita, mereka berasal dari kita. Kita-kita ini, mahasiswa-mahasiswa biasa ini, yang akan menjadi pemimpin dengan syarat-syarat ini. Itu saya rasa yang bisa menjadi dorongan untuk pemerintah. Jadi mungkin itu yang ingin saya sampaikan, mudah-mudahan teman-teman bisa mendapat maksud saya, bahwa di bagian satu tadi, bagaimana Rusia mengatasinya, kemudian yang bagian kedua, bagaimana mahasiswa diaspora Indonesia di luar negeri dapat berkontribusi buat bangsa. Dan yang ketiga, bagaimana supaya kemampuan kepemimpinan itu tetap ada dan terbawa. Jadi saya rasa itu semua bisa terangkum, mudah-mudahan bisa dimengerti oleh teman-teman. Mungkin itu yang ingin saya sampaikan. Terima kasih banyak, semoga bisa membantu menjelaskan kepada teman-teman. Terima kasih.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Ferlito, for your presentation. Before we are moving to question and answer session, I express key points from Mr. Ferlito about how the Russian to combat coronavirus. The first, Russian implement temporary state for combating coronavirus. The second, Russian prisoners, students, and military produce medical equipment. And the third, Moscow City, especially, made a digital permit and made massive check. And Russia made massive tests too. And in every metro and public area has a disinfectant spray and check its temperature. Thank you for your attending, Mr. Ferlito. And now we are moving to a question and answer session. The first Q&A I give to my colleague, Mr. Helmi. That belongs to you, Mr. Helmi.
Thank you, Mr. Reddy from Russia. Ati govoris po-ruski. Okay.
Da.
Okay, audience and speakers, actually before we move to question and answer session, we will have some discussion among the speakers, actually. And we will discuss something also very interesting. For example, the speakers, all of the speakers already share their experience, their opinion based on the country they're living now. A lot of technologies that have been used. So one question remains, like, which technologies from each country, like for example from Hong Kong, from China, from South Korea, for example, and which can minimize the risk of COVID-19. So from each country, from China, from India, from Russia, and also from South Korea, is there any technology that can contribute to Indonesia or even for other countries in pandemic and post-pandemic? Maybe any of the speakers can give some opinion, which technology, like we talk about the compatibility of this technology, which one can be used or can be implemented in Indonesia. Maybe we can discuss this, if any of you can give some any response, please join me. Maybe Mr.
Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar.
Nikolai Ali Akbar
can give the opinion. So we can see a lot of technology in China.
A lot of technology in China.
This pandemic. So is there any technology that compatible to mitigate this pandemic?
Okay. Thank you for the question. The question is which kind of technology that is compatible in China that we can use also in Indonesia. The first one that I think that we really can use is the real-time screening that we face in the public places such as the bus stations or in the airports or in the train stations. So we could implement the screening methods there to check whether the people going into or out from the station or that public places has any fever or not. Right now we use the infrared thermometer to check the body temperature, but it still needs some context, a physical human context between the guard or the officer holding the thermometer and the person or the people getting tested. So but by using the screen time, the real-time screening methods using artificial intelligence, I think and I believe that it will decrease the rate of physical contact, and furthermore, it could decrease the rate of infection of COVID-19. The second one is, I think, and I believe, the tracking system is also could be used in Indonesia so that we could know and the actual condition of which part of Indonesia which is safe and which part of Indonesia which is not safe, which one is the red zone, which one is the green zone, or which one is the whatever yellow zone or any other colored zones that we might have according to the situations here. Because according to the information right now, we only rely on the announcement made by the government officials regarding the condition of COVID-19. Like the spokesperson of the COVID-19 task force of the central government always give us up-to-date information about the condition of COVID-19. But I think that if we always have the like press conference each time, then it will take too much time, it will take too much resources. But if we use the tracking system using the big data in Indonesia, I think that it is the most efficient way to give information to the people, since most of the people in Indonesia, most of our people always have gadget in them. Even the person or the people in the rural areas always have gadget, at least smartphone in their possession. So this could be utilized to give information to them. Although the problem in creating the big data system, the big data tracking system in Indonesia is of course the connectivity in each regions, in each province, in each cities or residents in Indonesia is different. Like there are some places that has the highest connectivity and there are some places that have the lower connectivity, so it might affect the data displayed in the tracking system. So this is the one of the problems that we need to face and we need to deal with. And the third one is we could utilize our social media to give information, to give actual knowledge about the development of the disease in Indonesia. As maybe most of us have realized that we always have received a text message from the COVID-19 task force from the central government through our phones. But I think that we could optimize that by giving them the actual data, the actual numbers of people infected, the actual conditions and the actual government policies that were being made in order to fight the COVID-19 in Indonesia. Those three points, I believe that we could utilize them since most of our people in Indonesia right now has been open-minded regarding technology. Most of the people has smartphone in their possessions, most of the people use social media in their daily lives, so we could utilize them to at least give them awareness of how important the prevention of the disease infection, about the importance of how do we deal with the new normal conditions, and the importance of how the importance of the people cooperating with their local government or even the central government, or even cooperating with each other, each citizen cooperating with each other in order to fight this disease and in order to welcome the new normal that we are going to face in the near future. I think that's what we can do and that's what we can implement in Indonesia. Thank you for the question. I return it back to the moderator, Mr. Hilmi.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar, for giving us your opinion. Perhaps any other speakers would like to deliver some opinions? And yeah, Mr. Ali, Ihsanul Kauli from South Korea.
Yeah, regarding the question about which technology can be implemented in Indonesia and the benefit of Indonesia gain for that technology. I think most of the technology we share in our presentation can be implemented, I think, but only for big city like mostly in Java and maybe some city in Sumatra or Kalimantan in Sulawesi. However, for the rural area and the villagers where they don't have sufficient infrastructure to gain benefit from such advanced technology like internet or AI or something, we need to rely on the existing infrastructure that our country have the most, like the radio station, also the national television, like TVRI. So I think using these two prominent infrastructure in Indonesia, the television and radio, the thing that we can do and we can implement is the mass spread of the information to the people, especially during the new normal nowadays, right? I remember my friend told to me that in my village, even though the government using a lot of information from the television, for example, people still, the villagers still don't know what to do and they don't even understand what coronavirus is. So I think the information has to be easily understand for the people. In our case, the student, we can understand English very well and we can understand the complex language. But for most people in Indonesia, I think we have to manage the language we deliver to the people
the and language
in the manner so then most people will understand what we are telling. And in doing so, I think the government will have, what is it, the central government, if they succeed to deliver the proper information to the people by using the easy language, the load at the moment to combat the coronavirus will be reduced significantly because most people understand what they need to do in order to avoid the COVID-19. So I think we need to rely on what infrastructure we have the most in Indonesia. Okay, I give it back to moderator. Thank you for the time.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Ali, for sharing us your opinion. As you mentioned that we can possibly use all this technology in Indonesia. So as also Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar mentioned, we can also implement the AI-powered technology. And also, I would like to highlight the important the data. The data should be very valid. We need to use, if you use artificial intelligence or machine learning based technology, all of the technology are based on the data. If we use false data, it will not work as we expected. So this is how we need to have some, you know, this is more sounds like more politics because in the initial state of this pandemic, we heard some rumors, you know, we heard that this government from this country, they didn't show the real number. They didn't show any valid, you know, information. So based on that, what is your opinion? Any opinion regarding this, the use of the valid data information? Maybe Mr. Randy from India.
Yeah,
it's quite difficult to say whether the data is valid or not, was showing by the government. But one thing that we must sure is that the government, they are really want to protect the society, especially for Indonesian to live it prosperous. And I cannot say whether the government, they will create the data with the different, in the different or in the real way. But in my perspective, is the concern is how we use every equipment, every tools to combat with COVID-19. Unfortunately, if we see, especially in many places, in my places in Lampung, many people was there is nothing happened with coronavirus. I don't know. Hopefully, the government more strictly make the regulation was implemented very well, because the regulation is very good, but unfortunately, the implementation is very weak. So the concern is how to strengthen, how to make the regulation or the policy be strengthened, be implemented very well in its area. That's all.
Thank you, Mr. Randy. Actually, due to our time limitation, we have two more questions to be discussed. I think we can take one question from the audience. We have already selected one question from the audience on YouTube from Ahmad Daniel. I think this this question is addressed to Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar, but I think all the speakers can also answer this question based on their currently place. So the question is, are these technologies that the Mr. Nico explained about the technologies that implement in China, are all available across China? I mean, as we can see, China is very huge country. So can you give us your opinion about this?
Okay, thank you for the questions. Yes, China is a really very big country. Like if all the province or the islands are Indonesia are combined into one mainland, maybe it will be as big as China. And some parts of China, especially the western part, is not really that developed, is not really that advanced in technology. So it is pretty hard for the technology advancement to be approached by the people there. But most of the technologies that I have presented to you, it's mainly being used first in the big cities, such as the capital in Beijing, and the second one is also is being used in some places that has that is considered as one of the highest infection rate in China, for example in Hubei and Hunan province. As for the other places, such as the western part of China, since it is mostly a rural area that is underdeveloped and is currently underdeveloping, these kind of technologies couldn't even be approached or couldn't even be exist there. But for the big data trafficking system mapping system, it is currently being used for the whole China. How? Because it is invented or it is being used by Baidu as one of the biggest search engine, one of the biggest technological company in China that is being used by most of the people in China. Like almost all of them uses Baidu services. So for the mapping system, for the AI, big data AI mapping system, is currently being used in the national level. But for the other technology, such as the autonomous vehicle, it is mainly being used in the big cities. And as for the screening, real-time screening, it is mainly being used in the public places, that has a huge or high human traffic, such as in the railway station or in the airport or in the bus station. And it is mainly used in the big cities first, and the second one is in the places that has the highest infected rate in China, like the top five highest infection rate in China, in order to reduce the infection rate in that kind in that area. Maybe that's all that I can share about the distribution of the technology in China. I give it back to moderator. Thank you for the question. I hope you could get the answer that you were looking for.
Thank you, Mr. Nico, for the answer. I hope also Mr. Ahmad Daniel can get the point that actually almost of the technology China tried to implement, but especially on the in the highest infected areas, as well as the capital, like in Beijing. So we can see that the Chinese government pay very serious attention for the highly infected areas. So I hope Mr. Daniel can Mr. Daniel satisfy with this answer. Before we move to the last session, closing statement and conclusion, there is one more question. Actually, is a very interesting, Mr. Ferlito. He mentioned about the global leaders, the preparation of the global leaders. As Mr. Ferlito mentioned, the leader should be prepared. We cannot select which can be a global leaders. It should be prepared. And regarding this situation, there's one question remain: how to increase the digital literacy to prepare our emerging global leaders? As you know, in Indonesia, the young generation, they will lead Indonesia in the future. So they need to have some more understanding, a lot of knowledge, information, especially in this era, digital literacy. So perhaps Mr. Farlito can give any insight from Russia, how Russia prepare the for young generation to lead the Russia in the future.
Oke, baik. Izinkan saya kembali berbahasa Indonesia. Jadi kalau misalnya dikatakan bagaimana caranya Rusia untuk mempersiapkan generasi selanjutnya dari orang-orang ini, biasanya ya, kalau di sini itu persekolahannya itu memang sudah terarah berbagai bidang. Ada memang pada saat sekolah dasar itu sudah ada berbagai bidang. Ada sudah bidang olahraga, ada bidang seni, bidang lainnya. Nah, itu mungkin dari situ mereka akan menjadi bibit-bibit di masing-masing bidangnya. Kemudian, pada saat setahu saya, perkuliahan dan sekolah-sekolah itu di sini sudah mengajarkan digitalisasi itu sejak sekolah menengah kayaknya. Mungkin sekolah dasar atau sekolah menengah pertama atau sekolah menengah atas sudah mempelajari itu. Jadi, mereka betul-betul sudah akrab dengan yang namanya digitalisasi itu. Nah, mungkin yang dapat kita terapkan di Indonesia, kembali lagi kalau kita mau terapkan, kalau nggak ada sinyal juga, sama saja. Nah, bagaimana penyeragaman atau mungkin bagi daerah yang tertinggal, pemanfaatan peningkatan teknologi atau mungkin peningkatan infrastruktur dalam hal sinyal untuk pendukung atau sinyalisasi dan lain-lain gitu, mungkin harus diterapkan, barulah mulai ke atas lagi bagaimana penyamarataan atau mungkin serta sinyal, bagaimana caranya supaya anak-anak sekolah ini bisa mendapat akses ke perangkat-perangkat tersebut, mungkin di sekolah-sekolah, karena kita tahu di sekolah-sekolah tidak semua sekolahnya sama kan, ada yang perangkatnya modern, ada yang masih tertinggal, nah bagaimana itu bisa terasa juga. Nah, dan akhirnya anak-anak nanti ini, anak-anak sejak jenjang sekolah itu sudah bisa merasakan yang namanya digitalisasi, dan mereka lah yang nanti akan menjadi pemimpin-pemimpin yang, atau mungkin masa depan kita yang tidak gagap lagi terhadap yang namanya teknologi. Mudah-mudahan bisa menjawab seperti itu.
Nah, terima kasih Mr. Ferlito atas jawabannya ya. Saya rasa juga salah satu bagian penting dari pendidikan adalah infrastruktur ya. Jadi memang harus disupport oleh itu semua. Dan Indonesia memang juga negara yang sangat besar sekali, dan pembangunan juga bila kita lihat terkonsentrasi di beberapa titik, tapi semoga pemerintah kedepannya bisa memajukan dan membangun Indonesia merata. Ya, kita sama-sama berharap dan tentunya Indonesia ada di tangan teman-teman yang menjadi pembicara pada kali ini ya, menjadi pemimpin-pemimpin masa depan Indonesia. Baik, kita masuk ke sesi yang terakhir, yaitu closing statement dan conclusion. Setiap pembicara mungkin bisa memberikan closing statement-nya. Setelah itu kita tutup webinar kali ini, semoga bisa bermanfaat untuk kita semua. Kita mulai dari yang paling jauh kali ya. Yang paling jauh negaranya siapa nih? Yang paling jauh negaranya dari India deh.
Mas Ablito.
Sepertinya masih di mute, Mas Randy. Mas Randy masih di mute mic-nya.
Oke, okay, akhirnya bisa. Tadi I just check, I try, but it cannot. Still mute, but now I can speak. Okay. My quote, I'm not really sure, but I believe in my concerns, whatever the problem we have, the sun is always exist tomorrow. So whatever the problem we have, just believe that there is a solution in the futures. Therefore, I always believe my quote for myself. There are four words that I always keep in my mind. There are senyum, semangat, berpikir positif, dan yakin bisa. So those four words always accompanies me for my journey. I always believe for everything. So by having smile and keep always positive and believe that you can do everything what you want. So just believe by yourself. That's all in my perspective. Hopefully, it also help you. The information that I give can help Indonesian and can motivate young people in Indonesia and in the world. And also, hopefully, this event can always do in the futures, hopefully not only for this month. Hopefully in the future it can frequently in a month. So many talented young people can also involve in this good event. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Randy, for the closing remarks. Now we move to Russia. Mr. Ferlito.
Okay. Baik, saya masuk lagi dalam bahasa Indonesia ya. Jadi mungkin untuk kata-kata penutupnya, dari tadi teman-teman ini dari berbagai negara dan mungkin yang kemarin dan yang kedepannya akan terus akan memaparkan masing-masing dari negaranya. Nah, cobalah kita belajar dari situ, negara-negara mana melaksanakan apa, negara mana melaksanakan apa, dan mungkin di kita sendiri kita belajar, dan juga mungkin teman-teman panitia juga kan pasti akan menyusunnya, mungkin memberikan rekomendasi kepada pemerintah kah, atau mungkin membuat apa. Nah, supaya itu bisa menjadi concern bahwa negara mana plus minusnya mana, negara mana plus minusnya mana. Kemudian untuk kita, untuk mempersiapkan diri kita di masa depan, kita yang akan menjadi orang-orang tertentu di masa depan, kita sudah belajar dari saat ini, gimana. Apa yang minus sekarang kita buat supaya kedepannya tidak ada minusnya lagi. Kemudian juga, jadi belajar dari semua negara tadi, kita mendengar dan kita pahami dan terapkan itu. Kemudian juga kembali lagi masalah penerapan lagi mungkin di negara-negara lain, penerap Indonesia mungkin mulai dari kita lah, mungkin ada orang yang lingkungannya bagaimana bisa menerapkan disinfektan mandiri atau apapun itu. Nah, itu mungkin dapat dimulai dari kita sendiri. Kemudian juga seperti tadi juga sampaikan, pembangunan infrastruktur supaya digitalisasi juga semakin baik, teknologi, sains. Kemudian juga bagaimana teman-teman PPI negara bisa memanfaatkan atau mungkin bisa menyalurkan kemampuan dan minat dari teman-teman mahasiswanya. Bagaimana diaspora di Indonesia di luar negeri bisa menyalurkan minat dari masing-masing orang itu supaya menerapkan menjadi sebuah hasil buat pemerintah apapun itu, menyalurkan dalam bentuk tulisan, webinar, dan lain-lain. Kemudian juga bagaimana anak-anak di Indonesia ataupun mungkin sekolah-sekolah tertentu di Indonesia dialurkan berdasarkan mungkin anak-anak yang science diantarkan untuk bagaimana cara membuat vaksin atau mungkin apapun itu, yang medis, membuat peralatan medis. Pokoknya bagaimana agar supaya pemanfaatan minat dan kemampuan orang-orang itu juga disalurkan dan dapat mendukung pemerintah dalam hal penanganan COVID-19 ini. Dan juga sebarkan terus berita positif, jangan sampai ada keraguan, supaya, karena pastinya kayak tadi Kak Randy sampaikan, semangat itu penting, senyum itu penting, pikir positif itu penting. Dan juga mari kita bersama belajar dari hari ini, belajar dari yang sudah berlalu, untuk menyongsong masa depan yang lebih baik. Gitu. Terima kasih.
Terima kasih Mas Ferlito. Ini pembicara-pembicara kita juga sepertinya tampaknya motivator-motivator handal nih. Kita sangat senang sekali ya dengan acara pada malam hari ini. Baik, kita lanjutkan ke Mas Niko dari PPI Tiongkok. Silakan.
Okay, thank you for the chance. To be honest, I'm confused, guys. Should I use Bahasa or should I use English? But either way, I use both then. I'll try to be bilingual, but not in a jacksaw way, but in the formal way, of course. When we are talking about technology, of course, this it has become one of the primary factor, has a primary role in our life right now and in the future. But one thing that we should not forget is that it is not the technology that shape us, it is not the technology that control us, but we are the one who shape the technology. We are the one who will use them, who will use the technology in order to achieve our goal. Bukan teknologi yang mengendalikan kita, bukan teknologi yang dalam tanda kutip memakan kita, tetapi kita yang menggunakan teknologi itu untuk mencapai tujuan-tujuan kita bersama di masa kini dan di masa mendatang. So I want all of you guys to still remember the spirit of our struggle, the spirit of our pursuit to achieve our goals in order to contribute more to our society, in order to contribute more to our nation. Although we are in the, we live in a different countries right now, although we live in a different time zones right now, maybe right now is evening Indonesia's time, but in another part of the world is morning. But by the use of technology, by utilizing the technology, we could still give our best contribution to our country. So guys, let us pursue our dreams, let us use whatever things, whatever factors, whatever knowledge that we could get from our respective country, especially in the technology field and in the many other fields, to contribute more to our nations while we got back in Indonesia in the future. Thank you. I'll give it back to moderator.
Okay, thank you very much, Mr. Nikolai Ali Akbar. Now we move to the closest one, Mr. Ali. Actually, he's very close from me. So, Mr. Ali Ihsanul Kauli, please give the closing remark.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Muhammad Hilmi. We are both in Korea, actually, at the moment. So, yeah, for the closing statement, I think we have shared our experience and ideas from respective countries. So the key is that the technology implementation is cannot be implemented by government only, or it cannot be implemented also by academia only. So the key point is the collaboration. So the collaboration among government, the academia, and also the industry. So, and I think this is the good opportunity because the COVID-19 is kind of a common enemy for all human being, right? Including Indonesian. So with this common enemy in front of us, we have to be united. And I think by uniting all the people, all the part of the people, the government, the industry, and the academia, we can together combat the COVID-19. And I think it is not possible for us to turn this crisis, this tragedy, into the opportunity in the future. And for us, the students, international students, for example, like the one in Russia, India, China, and in South Korea, our duty is, at the moment, is the most prominent one, the most important one is to study hard and to improve our skill, because in the future the challenge will be in highly different level. So prepare ourselves by studying hard and improving our skills, not only hard skill like computation or mathematics or something, but also the soft skill by joining the International Student Association like here in PPI Dunia. So I think that's all what we can share to all of our audience. Hopefully we can manage to combat the COVID-19 and turn the crisis into opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ali Sanulkoli from Republic of Korea. Now I will give the time to my colleague, Mr. Francesco Redi Caro, to officially end this very wonderful meeting. Mr. Redi, the stage is yours.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Hilmi, for the stage. Thank you for all the speakers. You are so amazing. You are so awful. Thank you for your contributing in this webinar. Thank you for sharing. I hope all of the sharing will be more to great to Indonesia and make our future leader too. Okay, thank you for your attention. And this webinar, I give back to my colleague, Mbak Mikkel.
Okay, thank you very much to all of the speakers, moderators, and viewers who were willing to attend from the beginning to the end of the event. A high appreciation for all organizing committee, our supporting team, and also our media partner. Before I close the event, I would like to inform you everyone one last time that we are also raising funds from COVID-19, especially for our medical team, who are at the forefront in fighting COVID-19. If you want to donate, please refer to the bank account number or scan the QR code as shown below or on your screen. Thank you very much to all of you who have contributed to the donation. Don't forget, we still have another event waiting for you. See you in our next event. Bye-bye.